I like that. You see the hand stretching. You know, I felt like Odell Beckham right there. Hey, welcome to episode 30 whatever.
He had a great game today.
Really? Can I get through the intros before you start?
37.
Thank you. Episode 37
normally,
of Addicted to Film.
Normally, you would
I'm talking
start
right
talking
through
football.
Travis. This is Travis Hopson right here, and I'm so proud of this guy. And we're going to talk a little bit about the proudness.
I feel like, man, I
don't want to say it because I don't want him to get all heated right now, but I'm really happy about this man right here.
I don't know why. What did I do?
I have watched Travis since he was a young Padawan.
We went through this.
He is, man, this dude right here, man, wow. I feel like, you know, when you talk about drunk uncle, I feel like old proud uncle.
How's I don't that? Know what the hell you're talking about. What did I
you
do?
You do realize it's a 15-year difference, man.
Oh, I know that you're a lot older than me.
Right, so that's why I said I could be older uncle. So anyway, I'm older. Tim Gordon, since Travis won't throw it back to me, but I'm good. The reason why I am really excited.
You distracted me with all your crap about me being your mentor again.
I didn't say the M-word.
You be
I never
mentor.
Used the M-word, man. But anyway, even though it's true. But anyway, the reason
this
why I'm proud of my friend is because tomorrow we will be announcing live at 8 a.m. On Cinema Royale the results of the 13th annual Washington, D.C. Area Film Critic Association Awards, which we call WAFCA. I, of course, am the president, and I generally, as a rule, am the one who does this, but I am not available, and Travis Hopson is going to become the first person outside of me to host this, and it's a big deal. It's a big deal.
It is a big deal.
It is a big deal, man. I'm not being funny. I'm really proud.
And I recognize that it's a big deal to be hosting this tomorrow, so I appreciate the opportunity and the confidence you have in me to do it. Because Lord knows you could have given it to anybody else, and I could have said no, but I didn't.
Like Travis.
I didn't. So because you know I respect our awards immensely. You know, I make fun of WAFCA a lot.
Right.
there are certainly plenty of things about WAFCA that I would love to see.
And people.
And people that I would love to see changed, removed, and so forth. But but I have immense respect for our awards each year because I do feel like we do a really good job of being independent, and I know there are some critics groups out there that, you know, that I feel are more self-serving with their awards than anything else, merely out there trying to get attention. I do not feel like that is the case for us, and since I know how we do our awards each year, I know how independent our process is. So I am looking forward to seeing the results of our awards later today, I hope.
Nope.
Rather than not tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
Right before I go on air. I'd like to know beforehand.
Now let me
thank
explain.
You,
let me
thank
explain
you, sir, for the
graphic.
Why
I at my direction, the team has now gone to this heavily embargoed awards results. I, of course, and the executive team have the results. We discovered several years ago, much to our chagrin, that, you know, how you have sites like Awards Daily and Golden Derby and all these guys who are awards predictors out in L.A. Somebody, well, actually, I know exactly what happened. This was before we went to, we only give you the awards an hour before.
Who leaked it and are they still
in
the group?
Well, we sent it to Allied and THP back in the day. And what happened is in their eagerness, and these are advertising or representatives of the studio here locally in D.C., and they literally sent the results in very happy in the studios in an effort to get it out, leaked the information to these sites. And we had a conference call like 11 o'clock that night. And I was like, from now on, never again will we give out our results. We embargo them until 7 o'clock. So Travis, who will host the show, will not know until an
until
hour before 7:59 the show.
a.m.
No, I wouldn't do
he'll
you like
me
that.
The, he'll
that
send
that
me
would
the
be gangster.
He'll send
I would
me the
be
email.
That way.
Can you make it like 6 or something? I mean, come on, man. Why gotta be 7?
7 o'clock.
7,
man.
I'm going to be getting online and making sure all my technical stuff is right. I was on the air this morning for the Punch Drunk podcast, and I was like, you know what will happen? 7:45, like all our electronics will just conk out, and you know, somebody ain't paid the electric bill, and everything will.
I've had that happen, man.
Crash.
Well, you know what I've done in the past, which is really funny. When I know we're going to do this.
Critics banner. How nice. Oh, that's Thank you, Mike Phillips.
You can't put a Film Gordon banner up there, man? Really?
He said he hadn't heard of it before.
Anyway,
he never mentioned it on here.
That's no problem. But as I was saying before, Travis, well, actually, that's true. I know
you never
have.
Mentioned it on here. That's why.
TheFilmGordon.com. Right. But anyway, I generally get up like 2 hours earlier. I'll sleep in because I want to prep it in order, because this is a big deal. I mean, you know, I also have the Black Reel Awards, which I equally put that much effort into.
Right.
But I'm glad you're doing this because I've been having meetings all week about the Black Reel Awards because the ballots go out tomorrow to everybody, and we're doing something this year we've never done before, which is we've created 4 distinct branches to nominate these films. So I am really eager to see how this is going to work tomorrow.
Are you going to do a live show for the Black Reel Awards this year? I haven't heard you talk about this in a while.
We haven't.
I was just, when you brought it up, it reminded me that used to be a topic of conversation. Now you don't have to talk about it.
Well, no, I'm not going to talk about it right now. But the nomination process, like I said, this year we're doing something we've never done before. We're going to, as I said, we talked about the 4 branches, and we're also accelerating the date. So you're going to vote for the nominees from this Monday to the 12th on Friday, and then we're going to announce the nominations on the 17th, and you're going to get your final ballot right after we announce the nominations, and the voting will go through the 22nd.
Okay.
So by Christmas, we will have the Black Reel Award winners for this year, which we will not release.
So by Christmas, Selma will already know that it's won the Black Reel Award before it comes out in the theaters.
Watch this. Here we go again. Tim doesn't vote. Travis votes. I have no clue how you and the crew are going to vote. Oh, that's nice.
There you go.
That's nice. That's pretty cool. And actually, the way he has it, which is cool, because he has me, my band under me, it would have been jacked up if he had done it the other way. I'd have been like, that's jacked, man.
Yeah, no, it's very good. Mike Phillips is the man.
So anyway, man, we're going to talk. We got a lot of film to talk about. And you came up with a very interesting idea today that we want to talk about tonight. Let's talk about that real quick.
Well, first of all, we're going to talk about the movie Wild, which is.
I forgot about that.
You say, I forgot about that, about a movie that I already know you like. So it's like, so
I do. I forgot about that
for a few minutes. But we're also going to talk about some of our least favorite movies of the year. And I brought in a bunch of clips of movies spread out throughout the year that I know I've seen and hated. And I assume that you have seen these movies too. I think you hate them all. There's one that I know you haven't seen, but I brought it in here because I've talked about it so much over the last few months.
There's one film, Travis, that
I couldn't bring
has not even
as much
come
as
out
I
in the theaters
to.
Yet. But I'm seriously considering putting it on my 10 worst of the list.
What is it?
A movie we saw a couple of nights ago that we saw clips of like a couple of months earlier. 50 minutes worth of clips.
Oh, yeah.
Dude,
We can't talk about that one, unfortunately.
Oh, I really do. We can't put that on the worst list even before it opens the theaters.
Well, you can do that, but we can't talk about it right now, unfortunately. So we can't even do what certain other critics would do, which is like rhyme the name of the title out. We're just gonna leave it alone. until next week. We'll talk about it.
Is that when it opens?
I think it opens on the 12th. So yeah.
Dude, all I can tell you is when people sit around me and laugh and your movie's not a comedy, it's not a good sign.
Me and our friend May Abdelbaki had a lot of fun at that movie.
Oh, no. I set Rebecca Cusey, who you know is a religious critic, set on one side.
Yes.
And Eli Savada, devout Jew, set on the other side.
You're giving away the movie.
I'm just saying, man. Woo! And I was sitting there doing like this the whole movie. Seriously? So anyway, movie's making my 10 worst list, but I will not talk about that one today. I will wait until it comes out.
I spent this morning, because at Punch Drunk Critics, the crew, we're doing our end of the year list like we always
already?
Do. Already? It's we're in the second week of December. It's really? The time to do it. Yes.
Oh, okay. I normally do all those shows toward like the end of the month, man. I do like
not
my
shows. I'm talking about our lists.
Oh, you're doing lists.
Like,
okay.
For our posts.
I got my list.
Those will be spread out throughout the month. Okay. And I spent this morning breaking down my top 20 movies. I got them all lined up, ready to go.
Uh-huh.
I got my my most popular post that I did last year out of this whole group was actresses deserving of Oscars attention but won't get it. You know, I always do that post each year, and I got that list set up too. So I'm ready to go starting tomorrow on this stuff. I know. Yeah. can't talk about it till next week.
Woo, you suck.
Well, let's talk about a movie that will not appear on either of our worst lists. Let's talk about Wild, starring Reese Witherspoon. Let's go ahead and run a clip of that, Mike Phillips.
I interview hobos for the Hobo Times, drive all over the USA, and I have to tell you, lady hobos, hard to find.
Oh, I think you're mistaken. I'm not a hobo. Second of all, that's a real thing, the Hobo Times?
Yeah, it's real enough to pay for my rent and gas. So, how long have you been out on the road?
I'm not on the road. I'm hiking the Pacific Crest Trail. I just had to bypass a chunk of it because there was a snowfall this year.
Okay, so if you're not a hobo, where do you live?
I'm between places right now. I'm probably going to live in Portland when I get off the PCT.
This is so fucking cool. I mean, I've only spoken to maybe one other female hobo in 2 years.
Let me reiterate to you, I'm not a hobo. And that's probably because women can't walk out of their lives. They've got kids to take care of. They've got parents to look after.
You sound like a feminist.
I am.
That's excellent. It's fantastic. I love feminists.
All right, that was a clip from Wild. And this is a film that I think has got a lot of people. What, man?
Go ahead.
What are you shrugging your shoulders for?
Yeah, it's Wild. Yeah.
You hold on. You like this movie
a lot.
In fact, yeah, you like it, it a lot. So why are you acting like you're disinterested in talking about the movie? Put your phone down.
Put
your phone down and talk about a movie that I know you were really into. We saw this at the Virginia. Virginia Film Festival. It was the very last film we saw. We were afraid we weren't going to get into it. Actually,
sure enough,
we were scared we were going to get in because it was packed and all this kind of stuff. And you saw it, and you were really into it.
I was.
Talk about Wild a little bit.
All right. Well, of course, the story is about. See, you do setup, man. I come in after you set up. You didn't set up.
Reese Witherspoon plays Cheryl Strayed, who's a real woman. Who when she was like 21,
a real woman.
Well, I mean, some of these stories are fake. So right. She's playing an actual person, Cheryl Strayed, who I think when she was like 21 or 22 years old, she's really young. Walked about 1,100 miles of the Pacific Crest Trail. She had gone through some personal problems in her life, death of her mother, drug use, promiscuity, a lot of stuff. Uh-huh. And she was trying to kind of walk back to herself, back to her old self in a way. So taking a literal journey into rediscovering herself, which I think is, most people wouldn't do that, but that's the path she chose. And she inspired a lot of people when she did it. Now, the thing for me, we talked a few months ago about this movie called Tracks, mm-hmm. which tells a very similar story. But these are two very different women. They're both real life people, like living people like who exist now. Mm-hmm. They're very different women, and the women have very different motivations. I like Wild better simply because I think it's directed better. And I think we learn more about Cheryl Strayed than we did about the woman in Wild.
Okay.
So I dug Wild a lot better, and I do think Reese Witherspoon is going to get her first Oscar nomination since Walk the Line.
Well, I would agree.
We did this on Around Town.
Town as well. Yeah, I knew this is kind of deja
sound
vu.
Sound familiar?
Yeah, it's kind of deja vu. Travis and I do so much of this stuff. I'm like, oh yeah, we did talk about this.
Yeah.
I agree. As you know, I thought Reese Witherspoon did an amazing job. I think for the first maybe 10, 15 minutes, you got to really kind of suspend belief because we see Reese Witherspoon a certain way. And I remember making a joke when we talked about this earlier. I said that Elle Woods from Legally Blonde has come a long way as an actress. Right. And I like some of the choices that Reese Witherspoon makes. You talked about Walk the Line, where she played June Carter. I thought that was a wonderful performance. I think in this film, at 38 years old, we see kind of Reese Witherspoon evolving into a character in a way that we have not seen her previously.
Let's look at some of the movies she's done recently.
Right.
She did this. She did Mud, which I thought she was great in last year. She did Devil's Knot, which is the true story of the West Memphis Three.
Right.
And she did The Good Lie, where she played a supporting role in in another dramatic effort. So, and she's in Inherent Vice, which comes out later this month.
Now, she also produced The Good Lie, she also produced Gone Girl.
She produced this film. She was not going to star in this film initially. It was going to be another actress. Because, like I said, Cheryl Strayed was much younger when she took the walk than Reese Witherspoon is now. But in order to get the movie made, you need a big star. And she went and did the role. I think they kind of aged her down a little bit for it. But I think she did a fantastic job. Now, I talked about on Around Town about my issues with the film, that I think it gets kind of lost in all of its flashbacks. This is a movie that spends a lot of time going back and forth.
But I
kind of got lost in it a little
bit. But I disagree from the standpoint I can't disagree that the flashbacks bothered you, but I don't think the film gets lost in the flashbacks. Right, right, right. I think the way they employ the flashbacks actually really works well, because they don't have to stop down and tell a story chronologically. You know, like we're going to start here and we have to go through all of these bad periods of her time. We start with her on this journey of this walk. And then the film gives you like these kind of like small little snippets of some of the things that occurred in her life, which put her on the path, literally put her on the path, as Travis said earlier, to walk back to herself. Actually, a good line. You know, Laura Dern is who's in this film.
They're talking about her for Best Supporting.
She actually was nominated this weekend. She wasn't a WAFCA nominee this weekend, was she?
Yeah, I believe she was, yeah.
Yeah, so she's really good in this film as well, playing her mother and that whole backstory. I also think that her issues, as you talked about, with promiscuity, some drug
use. She's a slut.
Damn.
Well, she was.
Well, I mean, yeah, she was. She was a slut. Well, there was something that happens in the film that kind of like took her over the edge. But I like the story, and I also enjoy, Travis, the aspects of the various parts of the walk that they employ, where she's out there alone. Because we think about it's all inspirational, and she's doing this walk, and we think about tracks as well. Mm-hmm. But you're thinking about a woman alone out in the woods, and they have some scenes that
dangerous.
Yeah, it is dangerous, and I think they did a good job of showing us
women
that.
Women don't generally take that walk.
No.
Women don't do it. It's rare.
I think it would be dangerous for a guy to take that walk. You never know.
A lone guy, yes, but a lone woman surrounded groups of guys taking his walk. There are a couple of scenes there where you wonder if something's about to happen, something bad's about to happen there, and you know, so there's some dangerous moments too in there. I agree with you for the most part. And this is directed by Jean-Marc Vallée, who did Dallas Buyers Club last year. So he helped Matthew McConaughey get his first Oscar. And every time Vallée does a film, he seems to get great performances out of people. Let's not forget, this is the guy who directed, I believe, The Young Victoria with Emily Blunt, which is like her breakout role.
Oh, yeah.
So you know, he gets great performances out of people, and I think he gets another one out of Reese Witherspoon.
Witherspoon is good in this film, and I love the fact that Witherspoon is not only a force in front of the camera, but as we said earlier, she's a force behind the camera. She's going to be at the Oscars either way, whether it's for herself, whether she'll be there for Gone Girl. She's going to be she'll be at the Academy Awards.
She's going to be at the Critics' Choice too. You know she will.
I know. I know. And we need to tell the people about that. We actually bought our tickets this week.
Is she married? Reese Witherspoon?
I'm trying to figure out if
I can make my run at her.
Well, you know, we have a good friend of ours, and he might be watching, so I'm not going to say his name.
Like an X-Wing fighter at the Death Star? at her.
Travis, you know this to be true, right? What I'm about to say? We have a friend of ours, it's a close friend who doesn't live here anymore, used to be a critic here, who actually made a run at an actress. And he showed me the pictures. I was like, whatever happened to her?
Was it a successful run?
It was a pretty successful run before he crossed the goal line with somebody else. But I was shocked that I was like, really? LA is like that? Well, damn. Sorry. Anyway, he made a run at an actress. She was an actress that you would know. Right. She was in a film that.
And you did tell me about this, and I forgot who it was. I forgot.
I can't remember her name, but I can see her face. But
remember what movie she's in?
What was the What was the film about the two or three guys that had the house party and they tore up the house?
Project X?
Yes.
Trying to remember which chick was in that.
Hey, Mike Phillips.
Oh,
if you can find the woman who was the lead in Project X and flash her picture on here.
I think I know who you're talking about.
My man. I was like, way to go. that would be like if I went out to Hollywood and like, who would be somebody who I would end up with? And you'd be that'd be cool.
Okay.
Rashida Jones. Like, Tim, you were seeing Rashida Jones? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You wish.
I'm just saying. Watch this. You saying that can't happen?
Alexis Knapp?
Yes.
I love Alexis Knapp. She was in Pitch Perfect.
Yes.
She was the leggy one in Pitch Perfect. Yes. Alexis Knapp is awesome.
You should make a phone call and inquire about
that. I remember you telling me about that now, by the way. Woo! I remember it being her. Yep. Alexis Knapp. Woo-wee. Yeah, she's pretty fine. So we are both going to be at the Critics' Choice Awards.
We'll be at the Critics' Choice Awards for the first time. Now, the other big news, and I'm excited, because we have an amazing interview coming up this Friday.
We do?
You forgot already?
Is that the Ava interview?
Yes, sir.
Oh, damn. We do.
We are interviewing Ava DuVernay and David Oyelowo for Selma, which will be on this show at some point because we can't play it Sunday.
We can't. I don't think
we could.
We could. It's an interview, not a review. We could play the interview.
Yeah. Is that her? I don't think that's her.
Go look for Alexis Knapp. Pitch Perfect. KNAPP.
Project. She was in Project X as well, but
That's not her.
Yeah, that's
KNAPP. Look for her pictures in Pitch Perfect. She's fine as hell.
But Selma, which received 5 nominations yesterday from WAFCA. Boyhood, by the way, 11 nominations.
Did we give it 11 nominations?
I'm sorry, not Boyhood. Birdman.
Okay.
Whew. Birdman, 11 nominations.
Wow.
Birdman.
You need to write down some of these numbers so I remember them.
No, but look, Birdman was, of course, I've told you, is my number one movie of the year. So I'm glad everybody else is where I am with this movie. Birdman is fantastic.
Birdman was in my top 10.
Birdman's in your top 10?
It's in my top 10.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, with along with 9 other movies.
I mean, I'm not going to go over my top 10. I got my top 10.
I said that, obviously.
There we go. There she is.
That's a little bit better. Yeah.
Mike Phillips, a buddy of ours, dated her. He started off where we were as a critic. That just goes to show you. Yeah, you can take that down now, but yeah.
See if you can find someone she's got the black hair. Like in Pitch Perfect.
Yeah,
she's awesome.
Nah. But anyway, man, let's talk about some of these stanky films, man. And before we talk about these stanky films, I don't know what clips you bought, but I want to set it up.
Okay.
By essentially saying that every year, Travis and I see, I don't know, both of us are north of 250 movies right now, easily. Oh, maybe 260 movies a year, right. Which in itself is an achievement. So think about this for a second. The average person, stop, bro, right there. How many movies have you gone to this year in the theater? I'm talking about like how many movies have you paid for like per month? Just give me a number.
Two.
Good. So that's two. What about you?
How many movies
do you pay for a month?
A month?
A month. Okay, cool. So these two guys, which I think represent the actual general public, generally...
You need a female perspective?
No, we good. Because watch this, I'm going to already set something
up.
Basically, these guys have paid for, like the average person, two movies a month, right? So over the course of 12 months, 24 movies a year, 24, 25 movies a year. Even if you added in the third movie a month, Travis, you're talking 36 movies a year.
Right.
Travis Hopson has seen well over 260 movies. So have I. We are averaging, I don't know, 20 movies a month.
I'm at 268.
You're 268? Okay. I'm at 266.
Okay.
So basically, we have seen an equal amount, and not necessarily the same movies, but different movies. So having said that, we have sat through a lot of really good movies because we did that show about a month ago where we were looking at
some really stank movies like that one right there, which I can't talk about.
We sit through some really good movies, but we also sit through a lot of bad movies. And that's what the next, are we going to the top or are we 5 out? Mike Phillips.
Okay.
All right, cool. So in the next half hour, we're going to have some fun talking about, as Joe Barber, my late partner, used to say, what he called them seat creaking movies. You know, when a movie's so bad, you're just rocking in your seat like, oh, yeah. So we're going to talk about some really bad movies. Travis, you know what we got, so you can start it off, man.
All right,
so
Mike Phillips.
What's yours?
Because I told Mike that my clips were just kind of random. So right, Mike, roll the very next clip. Should be clip two.
All right. Let's see. People.
The Legend of Hercules, ladies and gentlemen.
Travis Hopson, that's a wonderful opening clip.
The Legend of Hercules, one of the first truly awful movies we saw in 2014.
And how funny was it when the clip started, I pointed like this, and we were at the same movie, man. So a little bit about The Legend of Hercules, man. This is the first of two Hercules movies. The second one
wasn't bad.
Right. The second one wasn't great, but it was better than this one.
Oh, this is definitely better than this.
Yeah, it's better than this one. You know, even in that clip you just watched, how ridiculous it is that not only does he have like the superhuman strength, but then there's all of the cool stuff in slow motion, which is really not cool.
Well,
it looks good, but it's really stupid.
I don't even think it looked good. I thought it looked crappy. And this is directed by Rennie Harlan. You remember Rennie Harlan?
Cutthroat Island.
Yep. Cutthroat Island. Yeah, yes. Yeah, yeah. One of the biggest flops in history, Cutthroat Island. Die Hard 2, I think.
Well, didn't he actually make the long? No, he did he direct The Long Kiss Goodnight?
I think he did.
Okay, well, that's a good one. That was a good one.
Long Kiss Goodnight.
Shane Black wrote it, so I think Rennie did that one, though.
Rennie Harlan, a relic of the 80s. Relic of the 80s and early 90s, yes.
Man.
Who has not made the transition very well since then, I would say. He's been pretty horrible. The movie looks like crap to me and stars Kellen Lutz as Hercules. Who the hell wants to watch Kellen Lutz for 2 hours?
Kellen Lutz is the equivalent of like what I used to think studios did with like superhero movies, where you would have guys who couldn't act worth a damn, but he looked good in the suit.
Right,
that's who Kellen Lutz is.
Right,
Kellen Lutz has one expression. Like you always hear me talking about Brendan Fraser and Keanu Reeves. Keanu Reeves is Marlon Brando next to Kellen Lutz.
Kellen Lutz is nothing. Kellen Lutz was also in The Expendables 3 this year, by the way, having that same expression.
Kellen Lutz is Kellen Lunghead.
But he got the one awesome motorcycle scene in The Expendables 3 too, though.
Very terrible. Stank.
So, yeah, The Legend of Hercules, it was one. I think that was the, what, the three, four?
Yeah, it was like
fourth. Third or fourth movie we saw.
So wait a minute, Travis. So what I've been wrong about is said, hey man, let's grade Hercules on a curve. Legend of Hercules on a curve.
There's no grading on a curve. It would suck no matter when you put it
out.
That
movie might have been hot if it came out in October.
You're right.
I'm just saying.
You know why it wouldn't? If Hercules with Dwayne Johnson couldn't really do anything over the summer with him, I think there's something wrong with the Hercules story.
All right.
I think people are just kind of like, eh. I don't need to see the Hercules story. I've seen it. I've read it. Nobody's interested.
Okay.
Because Dwayne Johnson can make $200 million out of anything.
Right.
I didn't put that on there.
You didn't put that on there, man?
I haven't seen it.
Come on, man.
I haven't seen that movie.
I got to give me some time Please. To riff on that before
no,
we get
done.
No,
this is a back and forth. You can talk about whatever you want
to
talk about.
All right. My first pick, because I agree with Travis's pick. Travis didn't see my pick. The first animated movie I saw this year, and I have it here, it's called The Nut Job.
You're not the only one I know. Everyone I know who's seen it has said it's a piece of crap.
Okay, now watch this. Let me just want to read the tagline here from the poster, Travis. No nuts, no glory. All right, so I'm just saying, this movie wasn't just bad, Travis. It agitated me and made me angry at how stupid it was.
There's absolutely no studio effort in that catchphrase.
No nuts, no glory. That's your tagline for this one, which is actually the worst animated movie of 2014. The story of some talking animals living in a park.
It was a contender in Best Animated in one of the awards, other awards groups I was in.
OFCA. I was like, really?
Because this goes back to a conversation that we had on our show earlier today. Mm-hmm. We were talking about the animated field, you know, because there's always like five movies.
Right.
You know, there's never that many. So you always get like one piece of crap movie that's thrown in there because, A, it's an animated movie. So this year it was like The Nut Job was in one. And Mr. Sherman and Peabody was in
the other. Oh my God.
Peabody and Sherman was in the other one, which I think is fine because I'm a big fan of that cartoon. So I was like, it's okay. But is it an awards movie? Hell no. But animated movies, you're only going to get a handful. And so you get junk. But The Nut Job just looks awful.
So anyway, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. But basically, it's a story of some animals that are in the park, Mike Phillips. And they kick this one overly klutzy, ambitious squirrel out the park. And he goes on an adventure where he ends up in a house with some 1930s types mobsters, which is the part of the story that was really stupid. What? Right, so these mobsters, if you think about like Edward G. Robinson and like, you know, it was like, what kid do you think would find something like that even remotely entertaining? Then you have the whole story where, you know, he's got a, you know, his colleagues from the far from the park come to help him out, and this whole thing about the bad dame.
This is more about The Nut Job
really
than I ever wanted
stupid
to
stupid movie, man.
But is it worse than that turkey movie from last year? Remember the one that was about the turkeys who were trying to stop Thanksgiving?
Same thing. Ugh. Same thing. Yeah, same thing. So,
oh my God.
Nut Job is the movie you hear me talk about and reference a lot.
No nuts, no glory.
Oh, man. So that's enough of The Nut Job. So The Nut Job is my number one pick. Travis, your turn.
All right,
give me your next stanky dank movie.
Roll my next clip, Mike Phillips.
He said he don't want to. Go ahead, man.
Did Linda tell you what to play?
No, she just said play.
Look, I mean, I've heard pretty much everything there is to hear, and I've got to say, you know, you're tearing it apart in your hands, man. Eh? Jesus Christ, no one's got you signed.
No, Jimmy, you're not really one for commitments, are you?
No.
Has Linda told you that I'm looking to...
So she's looking for people who'd like to work with, right?
I want to manage, but I've never managed an act.
I've never been managed.
That's even Steven.
Okay. I'm off the tour in 3 months. I think it'd be a hell of a thing if you came over to London.
London, man. There's so many great cats over there already playing, though.
Well, they haven't got you. Yeah, that's for damn sure. There'll be no stick in the ass about this chord or that. They'll be mad for what you're doing over there. Eh? I mean, everybody who's doing out, they're all working off the blue structure.
No, but see, I don't want to get caught up in those kind of labels, though, you know? I don't want it to be, okay, well, oh, he's playing no blues, or he's playing, like, you know, R&B or soul or whatever, all that kind of stuff. Those cages, man.
I'm not saying that it has to be.
It's not about style, you know? I want my music to go inside the soul of a person. You know, for me, it's colors. I want people to feel the music the same way I see it. You know, it's just colors. It's it, and the rest is just painted with a little science fiction here and there. I don't want to freak you out. It's just early.
I've got to get you over to London.
You see Imogen Poots's face right there? No, that was the kind of face we had looking at that.
Let me do my Andre 3000.
So you're Travis, you know. When we do this show, I want you to. I want the audience to see the colors of this show.
Try to get the color of a person.
The color of the person.
To get the color of a person.
Andre 3000, you know, dude, you my man, right? Outkast, you and Big Boy, y'all rocking it, man. You know, Southern player. What is it? Southern Cadillac player. Music. Whatever. Outkast, y'all hot. But dude, this movie here. Well, see, there's some big problems with this movie. Even that supersede.
Hard to believe this Andre is written Benjamin. By John Ridley.
Man, the guy who wrote, believe it or not, last year's Best Picture winner, 12 Years a Slave, wrote this movie.
John Ridley, as a screenwriter on
his
own.
He's good.
All on his own. He wrote something else this year that wasn't that great, too. I mean, John Ridley he struck gold with 12 Years a Slave, although I do believe that movie was half written itself anyway by the book.
But let me tell you something, though, man, about John Ridley. John Ridley's a guy who I respected a lot. He wrote U-Turn. I mean, he's wrote a lot of really successful movies. He actually wrote a book that I love years ago called Conversations with the Man. John Ridley, wonderful writer. This movie here hamstrung from the ability that, first of all, that the Hendrix estate would not release any of the music, so that they had to create a story that talks about Jimi Hendrix before Are You Experienced drops in 1966. And that's essentially the biggest problem with this film. It's almost like trying to watch Get On Up if you couldn't have any of James Brown's music and you had to tell like a James Brown kind of like prequel, or not prequel, but like a coming of age James Brown story.
Question for you.
Yes.
Black Reel Awards nominated him for Undercover Brother in 2002.
Yes, we did. And let me tell you something publicly here on this show that we tell people all the time. We watch this. We are an awards show. All we can do is honor the best of what's there. So people used to always crush me. I'm like, dude, you need to crush them filmmakers. So it's like, so yeah,
I only just happened to notice it when I was looking up John Ridley, because I knew he had written
2002.
Something. Yeah, 2002. He wrote Undercover Brother, which
I thought it was a fine movie, but it shows Travis that probably you got to look at what else came out that year. Here and there.
I want to freak you out.
You keep playing early. Some more. Look at that guy over there.
You see the look on our face like, what? But yeah, man, you got to look at what else was out that year. So John Ridley, man, I think he's done some wonderful work. Undercover Brother was funny.
It was a funny movie. I was surprised to see it got nominated for anything. In fact, the only thing it got nominated for was Black Reel Award.
Wow. Thanks, Travis.
For putting
yourself on blast.
I was not there in 2002.
So you didn't do it in 2002? You weren't there in
2002? I was not there in 2002, so I take no responsibility
for that. Yeah, but Jimmy All Is By My Side is
all I'm going to say is look at Imogen Poots's face next to him. She's looking at him like, this guy is giving me nothing right here. I got no.
Woo! Wow.
All right,
Travis. So let's move on, man. My second movie that's on this list is another movie that Travis did not. He was lucky enough to have missed this one. And the movie is simply Repentance.
What the hell is that? You've talked about that movie to me.
Repentance stars.
Is that Anthony Mackie, right?
Now listen to this. Here's the cast. Oscar winner Forrest Whitaker, Anthony Mackie, Mike Epps, who, sparkle, and Sanaa Lathan star in a movie where the tagline is, "You can't take back a lie."
That sounds like one of those cheap-ass movies that comes out and nobody ever sees them. They just kind of vanish. And that's a cast. You read that cast like it was like you should be impressed by it. That's a cast.
Whitaker, Mackie, Epps, and Lathan.
That's a cast of 50% from the field goal range, like a motherfucker, man. Those guys,
man.
All of them, even Mackie.
Well, you and I always talk about Forrest Whitaker. You call him like, what do you call him? 25% man, and like he'll make like one really good movie out of every four, role,
and then like the next four are just shit.
Well, guess what? This is one of those that wasn't a good one. This is a movie about crazy serial killers. Remember, I told you I went to Urban World and saw like this really wretched movie that was like a 1970s throwback. Like the entire audience was laughing.
Yeah.
This is what Repentance was. It was so bad. I'm just telling you, people, I want you guys to really write these titles down and like not only skip them in Netflix, Redbox, but when they come on cable, just turn the channel. There's no entertainment value with Repentance, The Legend of Hercules,
It's not even bad funny.
Oh my, right, not even bad, no, not even at all, not at all, man. Repentance was absolutely wretched and stank, and it is the one movie that, like, we in L.A. at the Critics' Choice Awards, and we walk into Forrest Whitaker and go, "Hey, man, I saw Repentance," and he'd be like, "What you talking about?" Repentance, you was in Repentance. I don't know what you're talking about, man. Repentance, what is that? So I'm always laugh, Travis, when actors are like in really, really bad movies. Like, imagine if Will Smith would be at the awards,
and
right?
And he brought up Winter's Tale.
Yeah, I'd be like, "Man, you was dope as Satan in Winter's Tale." He'd be like, "Winter's Tale? What you talking about?"
Oh man, I don't know nothing about no Winter's
Tale. Right.
All right,
go ahead, man. All right, your turn.
I think I have an idea of what my third one is, and if it is, I think it's Maladies. Roll clip number three.
Oh man.
His followers, mostly poor black men and women, gave Jones their money and their loyalty. Put your hands up. Put your hands up.
first steps in economic equality, a utopian society. But after some negative publicity, Jones moved his church and his followers to Guyana.
James.
Mm-hmm.
James?
What?
We're watching that. Thanks.
Oh.
Will you move, please? James, why would you do that?
What?
Flash is so bright. We're trying to watch the television.
She likes her picture taken. Right, Patricia?
Yes.
See?
Where'd you get that white shirt?
The shirt?
Yeah.
The shirt is blue.
Okay.
What are you doing? Laundry?
So I had some extra time out. I thought I'd just fold your shirts. Make a nice pile.
I knew I put on one of my white shirts today, but blue was the better answer. Blue.
Imagine an hour.
What in the hell was
imagine
that?
Imagine an hour and 45 minutes of shit like that. That is why I bring up Malady so much, and I was glad I was able to find that clip. Can you figure out anything that was going on by watching that clip?
What was the whole thing about her hair blowing when he's taking the picture, and then she comes back with the whole thing?
It was artistic. Didn't he know it was artistic? That's all it was. God, now, the guy who directed this, whose name I don't remember, is a friend of Franco's. They did like some projects together, like art projects together. They always work together on stuff like that. So this was him. I think it's his directorial debut, is feature-wise anyway. So, of course, Franco was in it. And this is the film I also told you that had, like, they're always watching TV, and it's always, like, footage of James Franco on General Hospital. And it's like the most pretentious damn thing I've ever seen in my life. And it's boring, just like that clip was. So that's how incomprehensible Maladies was at the beginning of the year for me. That movie hurt me. I was like, this can't be how the rest of the year is going to be,
you
right?
You said it hurt you.
This can't be how the rest of the year is going to go, right? Because
right.
It was one of those early movies. I was like, nah, man.
All right, my turn. Now, Maladies. Again, as a rule, people, you hear us use terms like low-hanging fruit. And I shouldn't do this. But, you know, it came down. I got to talk about this next movie,
all right,
man.
All right.
This movie I'm about to talk about is so bad. Watch this. This movie is so bad that the studio that he had a relationship with for a decade kicked him to the curb. And he still has no deal despite having $700 million in grosses for all his films. And I'm talking, of course, about Tyler Perry. And I'm talking about The Single Moms Club, which is absolutely one of the 10 worst movies of this year. And let me just tell you how bad it is, not by talking about the movie, but to illustrate the story of what happened when I went to see this movie. And I think I told you this story, Travis. You listen to this, man, because this is good. I went to a midnight screening of a Tyler Perry movie because everybody who's a critic knows that Tyler Perry doesn't screen his movies for us. So he forces us to pay for his subpar films, right? I show up, and there are about 20 people in the theater, right? And I'm kind of asleep because that was a day I was tired because I saw two or three other movies previous to this day. But I wanted to get in and get this out of the way.
You ended the day on?
I ended the day with this. So I'm sitting in the movie, true story. And I'm watching it, and I look around me, and there are people sitting to the right, to the left, behind me. And, like, I kept nodding. And every time I would come back from a nod, there'd be less people in the theater. So I nod the first time, I look to the right, and I come back, and, like, the people to the right are gone. I nod again, the people to the left are gone. By the time I got to the end of the movie and nodded and came back again, there was two ladies sitting behind me who are the prototypical audience for a Tyler Perry movie. And this is exactly what they said.
Oh,
excuse
Lord.
The language. I turned. I said, where's everybody at? She said, they gone. This is the worst piece of shit I've ever seen. This movie is horrible. I said, I looked at them. I'm like, but y'all are the Tyler Perry audience. I know. A Single Moms Club, which is a story of four women who just group together, who all none have a man, they try to get together, all that's immaterial. What is special about this movie, especially bad, I may add, is that, wait, hold on a second, is that weed? Cool. Anyway, what is especially bad about this movie is that you had a situation in here where it looked like Tyler Perry was speed directing. And what that basically means is that, you know, most directors might have 10, 15, 20 shots. We set it up. We try to get the best angle. We try to get the best pull, the best performance. It looked like Tyler Perry was like, all right, we're going to shoot this once. Go. And then he'd sit there and watch it and go, all right, we're going to do it one more time. I don't care what you do. Just give me one more. And then I'm out. That's the way the whole film looked, Travis. It looked like the actors were unprepared. The dialogue, it was just like, all of it is just...
He just described every Tyler Perry movie ever.
But this one is notable because it's the last film under his Lionsgate deal.
Now what about the animated Madea movie he's got coming out early next year? Isn't that with Lionsgate still?
I am not going to see that.
Of course you're not, but I mean, it exists. That's all I'm talking about.
Oh, my.
Wait a minute.
He's got an animated movie with Lionsgate coming out?
It's an animated Madea film. I thought that was Lionsgate. Watch this.
Is anybody crying out for this? Is there a demand? Like, we got to get an animated Madea movie.
Somebody paid him to make that crap.
Yeah. Did you? Were you looking for that? You weren't checking for that either? Okay. We have a studio audience here, so I'm having a lot of fun, man. But go ahead, man. You're up with your next movie. So.
I roll. We're going near the top. Go to my next clip, Mike Phillips, whatever the hell it is.
Listen, I'm sorry. I know this is not going well. I haven't been on a date in 20 years.
I haven't been on a date since senior year.
Did you get married in college?
Yeah.
Me too.
Really?
Yes. Is this not the weirdest feeling in the world right now?
You know, I think I will have one of these buffalo shrimp, and I'll have it with the sauce.
Excellent.
Oh my God.
It's hot.
Oh my God, who makes sauce this hot?
Tim's favorite movie, Blended. Now the thing about Blended that's interesting. You know, Sony was hacked recently, right? Sony was recently
hacked. And they deserve to when they release
Sony,
this.
Sony was recently hacked. A whole bunch of their movies got released, right. You know, early. Fury got released again and right. Some movies that are coming out. But they also released a whole bunch of internal documents. And part of those internal documents, along with like the salaries of some of their stars, there was also some internal comments from people who worked within Sony.
Right.
And there were a long laundry list of comments from Sony employees talking about, y'all need to get the fuck away from this Adam Sandler dude. They were all about how terrible the Adam Sandler brand is, how it's costing the studio money.
Excuse me, did you just say the Adam Sandler brand?
Adam Sandler is a brand. You know he's a brand. If he's a brand, he's a car,
he would be like a Yugo.
No, but he's a brand the same way Tyler Perry's a brand. I mean, Happy Madison is a brand. And whether we like it or not, his movies make money. His movies make $200 million a pop.
Why?
Most of the time. Well, I mean, obviously, you and I know that. But the funny thing is, the people within Sony who distributes and pays for these movies, they know it too. And they're trying to tell the top brass, stop making these Adam Sandler movies. They're fucking awful. Blended, I think, is probably one of the worst he's ever done. And that's saying something. Because, you know, I have always contended that he makes movies, you know, as paid vacations with his buddies.
I agree.
Blended was just another instance of that. He gets paid to hang out with Drew Barrymore in Africa this time. But Blended is one of the most awful movies, god-awful movies. I didn't laugh once. They're lucky I didn't bring in any clips of Terry Crews in this movie. Because I think he personally set the race back about 30 years with his role dancing around like Mandingo.
Can I just share the story again? Because we talked about this. Mike Phillips, again, another true story. At the screening of Blended, Travis was there. Did we sit together or were you in another area?
We were near.
All right. I sat on a row and I remember looking to the right and the left, like as the jokes were going on, quote unquote, quote the unquote, jokes.
Quote unquote.
See
jokes.
The air quotes, the jokes. And nobody moved. Nobody's laughing, right? And it, except this
There's one
lunatic.
Guy behind
this one guy that's
who
behind us.
Blended
who,
was the
I think he was the writer.
Shit he ever
I, thought
seen.
He, I think he was the writer.
I think they brought him in from the methadone clinic.
Oh my God, man. But anyway.
They just trucked him in and dropped him off, said, laugh, motherfucker.
As I'm sitting there enduring this movie, thinking, how am I going to get through it? The movie gods answered my request. The print stopped halfway through. And this is the funniest part of the story. I get up. This is my opportunity because I wanted to walk out anyway. I get in my car and go to the crib. I'm home. I get a text from Travis. Hey, man, they letting people back in, man. Where you at? I said, at my house.
He's right. Oh, my He's God. Right. We had a damn fire alarm during the middle of the movie. And that joint cleared the fuck out. All right, we're going.
All right, yeah, all right. That's cool.
So cleared the fuck out. And I stupidly came back because I was like, it took me forever to drive home anyway. So I was just like, all right, I might as well just hang around and see the end of this piece of shit. And it was a piece of shit, as expected. And there's my post on it. Adam Sandler movie sucked just as Sony. So with the worst possible picture of Adam Sandler on our website. So you go to punchdrunkcritics.com, you can see all of that. See my write-up about how the people within Sony think that he sucks ass.
All right. We follow up that amazing stank-a-dank movie with arguably, I don't know how to describe this movie, but I'll just, because I always have wonderful stories with these movies. The next movie I want to talk about is A Haunted House 2. Marlon Wayans. All right, true story again. I always love my true stories. I didn't go to a screening. I paid because we had to talk about it that Sunday. So I saw this on a Sunday afternoon.
We didn't interview him for this one, did we?
I interviewed him, and I knew when I talked to him that the movie was crap.
Right.
And I played it off anyway. I was like, all right, man, I can't wait till your next movie, man. That first one was.
And I did that for the first one. I interviewed him for the first one.
Oh, man.
And I bullshitted and said it was all right when it wasn't all right.
All right. I'm at the movie theater watching A Haunted House 2, right? Let me describe it, set it up for you again. Empty theater. I'm sitting down here. There's a guy about five rows back, right? Me and him, we're the only two in the theater, right? This movie is so bad. I'm not making this up. So bad, I pull my phone out after about 15, 20 minutes, and I write a post, and I wish I could find it on Facebook. I said, I would like to apologize to Tyler Perry for calling him the worst filmmaker. Tyler Perry movies are Citizen Kane compared to this. And you just heard me talk about A Single Mom's Club less than 5 minutes ago, how bad that was. This movie was so – the opening joke. Did you see this movie?
Yes.
The opening joke set the tone for the entire movie. They're riding in the car together. Regina Hall is back from the first movie. She's possessed. She's like harassing him. I forget who was it. Afon Crockett?
That guy.
The comedian?
That guy is annoying as fuck.
Is in there. So this sets the stage for a movie that included what I think is one of
the. You know what I mean, homie?
Right. They set it up for, I think, arguably the most offensive and worst scene of any movie I saw in 2014, where Marlon Wayans was not just screwing a doll that was supposed to be possessed, but it was like this kind of, I mean, how can I explain this?
It went on for like 10 minutes.
It went on for like 10 minutes, but it was like disgusting. Like who thought that was funny other than you and the crew that y'all wrote this movie over the weekend? Who else thought this was funny?
I don't know anything that was funny about that
movie. Oh, my God, man.
Yeah, and he has this, I don't know what it is, his weird sort of fascination with having sex with inanimate objects in these movies. He does it a lot in the first one, too. He does it in this one. And it's like, it's never funny. And he just keeps going with it. And I don't understand, man. But A Haunted House 2, I can't remember what that one did. I know the first one made money.
Oh, God.
I think the second one probably made money, too.
That
but those were atrocious.
Terrible, man.
Unfortunately, we're about out of time here.
We're out of time, man. So let's just go through some of the other ones. You got any other movies we could just talk about really quickly? Not talk about, but just give out some titles.
I love the slip and slide.
Oh my!
Well, I'm sure you did, yeah.
Oh God!
I forgot I put that one on.
Woo! Oh, this movie was terrible.
Yeah. Artie Burns. I play with Leah at the old.
This was and so it goes.
Well, I came here to pick her up.
What, you mean on a date?
Yeah.
No, you're not her type. She likes the man with actual hair.
Well,
Oh, yep. Transcendence.
Oh!
Also, yep. Mike Phillips with a montage, quick montage of clips. How many more we got, Mike? Okay, one more. This one was atrocious, too. Tons of potential in Transcendence. Directed by Wally Pfister, the guy who has been Christopher Nolan's cinematographer for more than 10 years, making his directorial debut in the movie Shit.
We're glad you're here. Ugh. Jesus Christ.
You're gonna blame him how drab the whole thing is.
Morgan Freeman couldn't save this movie.
This may have one of the best casts of the year, and it's one of the worst movies.
On what?
Ugh.
Can you prove?
Ugh, what's next? Good Lord. This shit is so boring. That's a difficult question. What is the next? What is the next clip? Good God.
Can you prove that you are?
I'm not a quitter.
This piece of garbage right here. Look at this scene right here.
It's all right. Go ahead, push. Got it. Do it. Do it.
Oh my goodness. Homicide.
Why is Susan Sarandon in this movie? You have an Oscar. Why are you in this movie?
Bad year for Susan Sarandon. She did Ping Pong Summer too.
Oh God.
Mark Twain. Bad year for her. Forest. Where are we?
This movie.
Yeah, that's what I said too. Where are we?
This movie made a couple hundred mil.
Mark Twain is right.
Hey, I mean it's Melissa McCarthy. People will pay.
Good guy. He's a good guy.
Oh my God.
A bad movie.
It was a painful, painful movie.
And before
montage,
we get out of here, there's one Mike movie Phillips. That is not in theaters yet. I'm just letting you know. Watch this. I'm just a studio, so y'all don't get me in trouble. It ain't even out yet. It's bad, y'all.
We can't.
All you gotta do is watch the original, right? Just watch the original. The original came out like 50 years ago.
We will talk about it next
week. Oh, it's terrible.
Next week's show.
Why is there's a little kid? Why is a little kid? What is that about?
Little kid's kind of awesome. But we will talk about that movie next week. You will find out what that terrible movie is.
Noah.
That Tim
keeps. Another movie. Tim Noah. Keeps,
I like Noah.
Noah was. Really?
I like Noah. So, okay. But anyway, we will talk about that
Labor
movie
Day.
And a lot more. Labor Day is bad. We'll talk about that movie. We'll try to talk about some of our favorite movies of the year because I will be gone the weeks after next week. So we'll try to get into some of our favorites too. But Tim?
Stay away, people. It is tomorrow morning. Make sure you check out Travis Hopson hosting the Washington, D.C. Area Film Critics Association Awards. It'll be at blogtalkradio.com/CinemaRoyale.
Yes. Just find it there. All right.
All right. We'll check you guys out. Stay away from them bad movies for real. Seriously. Stay away from them.
We're out of here, y'all.
We told you already. Don't do it.